So I'm Bilal McMurray, I work for Red Hat, and here it's going to talk about what we do with Coversity, what we do for crash testing, and what we're doing for fuzzing, and some pictures and graphs of our results over the last, over a year. I did the Coversity results and they're old for last year at the last conference. So this is the Coversity part of things. We've been using Coversity for over a year, maybe a year and a half, maybe. Well, we've been using it all the way back to open office times, but we've been using it more intensively and paying attention to all the results. So these are various examples of results that Coversity found in our code base, so real problems that were discovered. So in this one here, it says the ref count was not initialized in the constructor. So that was there's no known. We don't know what kind of problems this caused in the real world, but it's the kind of thing that definitely would cause some sort of a problem. Uninitialized ref counts there. These are data code examples, a part of code which logically could never be executed again, generally a cut and paste mistake. And this one then was the kind of most common type of mistake we had, where we had exception specifications that didn't match what we're actually throwing. This isn't an example of this. This is an example of somebody thinking they were throwing an exception, but it doesn't actually match the exception specification, which got an extra pair of brackets in it. Throws something that throws an exception, that returns an exception. Forward nulls, where we dereference something that's null after checking that it was null. The constant expression result. Here's one that I had in my code, so I must have written this when I was working in Star Office and I left out a zero, so I had 002 instead of 0002. I obviously never found that, so that was there since maybe 2000 or 2001. And I discovered that last year, so that's a 14-year-old bug that was discovered by Coversity. So Coversity does find real problems. It often finds lots of other things that are not problems, so you get a huge amount of noise. And especially for us in LibreOffice, that every time we refactor something that we'd marked as being a false positive would return because the code changed sufficiently that it was no longer seen as being a copy or a duplicate of the previously marked as a false positive bug. So our to ignore is massive. So basically we set off to try and get rid of all of our Coversity warnings, mostly so that when we got new warnings, we could know that they actually were new warnings and not old warnings returned again. So we put a big effort in there over the year and a half. So this is the contemporary results. Yes, last year's density was 0.08. This year's density is 0.00. And we haven't had 0.00 for about 6 months or plus. We had statistically zero for that length of time in practice. For instance, today we have four bugs in Coversity. We had a run. It found four bugs or four warnings. We fixed those four warnings, and the next Coversity run is still pending to come back to see if it'll actually be an actual zero or whether it's found more stuff. But I would expect it to be statistically zero. And this then compares to projects of our size, and we're obviously in this large bracket. These are the amount of defects that are in our Coversity database over time. That is 2012 and 13, and then that's obviously now. The warnings from Coversity in this chart include the ones that belong to the projects that we have set to be ignored and all of the things we've marked as false positive. So this is your floor here. You can't go below that unless you go and fix our third-party dependencies. For the most part, it's been a downward slope. You get these upward spikes every now and then, especially when exception specifications are modified a little bit. And that's what the large jump there is. So you go up from times and you come back down again. How we integrate it. Coversity gives projects, open source projects of our size. Currently it gives us two slots a week. So you can do two builds a week and then you can build again until a week later. So the way I do it is I don't evenly space them out. I do one build for Coversity, I get back the results, I fix those warnings, and then I do another build immediately. So that way I try and get this case where we had generally actually zero warnings, and I can use the second slot to verify that the results of the first slot are actually fixed. If you get it wrong, then you have to wait an entire week. So that's what I do, two back-to-back instead of evenly spaced out during the week. The way it is now is that because there's such a small amount of warnings generally, I have the results mailed to the email list, so you get your Coverity email once a week, and it'll list in the email generally the lines of code that have been affected that have caused the new warning. So you generally don't have to visit the website. All those earlier screenshots is the website UI for digging down into the bug. I generally give send an email out from Coverity to everybody that has commit access for, you know, a couple of days. Every week or two I send out an invitation from Coverity. So if you have commit access and you'd like to use Coverity website, and if I haven't sent you an email, then just let me or Norbert know and we'll just add you to the invite list. I generally don't give access to people outside the project that ask to observe the bugs or whatnot, because there's a lot of historic stuff there that might have some significance. I don't want to have people digging through 3 or 4 year old warnings looking for stuff to see to any vulnerability vulnerabilities there. But yeah, all new stuff is mailed to the list, it doesn't matter so much. So it takes about 4 or 6 hours on this laptop right here to build on our side, and you upload it to the Coverity website. And then it takes about 12 plus hours to analyze on their side of things, up to a day. The Coverity we're using is 7.6.0. I've just upgraded to 7.7.0, and the Coverity servers are now claiming that the build fails on their side. So either we've broken 7.7 or we have some other problems, so I'd have to try and get in contact with the Coverity admins to either see if there's a problem that they can fix, or I might have to revert back to 7.6. So that's the Coverity stuff, pretty much unchanged status-wise from last year, except now we email results to the list and our numbers are far smaller, they're smaller than last year. It's kind of integrated into our process. Crash testing then was the follow-up project. So this is basically, Mark has got this up and running. What we're actually doing is we're loading a whole pile of documents and then we're saving a subset of those documents and see if anything crashes. And by crash in this case, we build it with a debug util build, so we're doing any asserts as being a failure as well. So when I talk about crashes, I'm talking about crashes or asserts. So for example, the existing crashes that we have are all asserts that don't crash in a release build. So it's a higher order of quality that we're holding ourselves here to. So when I say that we have this many crashes, if you actually get a real world version of LibreOffice that's release build, it's not going to crash anywhere near as much as we claim here. So on the input side of things, we have 118 columns in our output, and each column is either a file format or a location where we get documents from. Some of these are kind of pointless now. We have a whole pile of StarOffice binary formats that we were loading, but now we're loading, and they're just no ops. They're just not being loaded fully at all. They're just being type detected and dismissed or loaded as text. So see if anything crashes. See if anything triggers an assert. Outside of the loading, then we save a whole pile of these documents. We load up all the ones from the compatible formats for output to the common doc, docx, odg, odp, ods, odt, ppt, ppx, or tfx, and sxx. So we export out to those larger Office formats. So we don't load up all the image formats and resave them to other image formats. We just do it for this. So if we load up an odt, we save it out into all of the compatible file formats. So one import of a doc or one import of an ODT turns into 3 exports. So it multiplies there. So that's what we're doing for the export side of crash testing. We have a large box that we rent time for this project for the crash testing. And it's got like 64 cores. Each core's got 4 gigs of RAM associated with it. It's a very big machine. And we load up all these documents, run this entire process once or twice a week. The entire process takes about 2 days or thereabouts to complete. And my documents we're using at the moment are about 80,000 import documents. Get these documents by using this script, mostly from this script, get Bugzilla by MindType, and that goes to our Bugzilla, the Red Hat Bugzilla, the Novell Bugzilla, the free desktop, the org Bugzilla, and other places like that. And it downloads all of the mind types that we support, at least 118 file formats. And it's clever in the sense that it only fetches the ones it didn't fetch the last time. I mean, we add to this big pool of documents the documents from Cloudon, who was working with us last year for interoperability with docx. So they have a whole pile of docx test documents that are part of our crash testing suite. We've recently added the W3C SVG test documents as well. And then I've added a whole pile of documents that I have in my own personal store of interesting documents, and we put them into the mix as well. So they're documents that would have caused trouble for some application in the past, either ourselves or the legacy back in the day, maybe OpenOffice.org or Inkscape or other applications like that. And they're not public for one reason or the other. Either I forget where they came from, so I can't make them public, or they were part of some proof of concept email from some security researcher back in the day. So the thing is, these 80 documents then are not your ordinary, you know, your ordinary document. These are, at the best of times, they've been created for a reason to demonstrate some problem or something slightly out of the norm, or they're crashers. I mean, obviously, there's going to be a lot more have caused crashes in the past documents, in documents downloaded from Mozilla, than there will be from just bringing them out of your own company's template directory or whatnot. And the ones down here at the bottom are, they're bad documents. These are the kind of documents that, you know, they live under bridges and they stab people that go by, you know, so they have a history. So that core then, as we would say, the process of doing get Bugzilla is mostly dominated, the get Bugzilla, get mine type from Bugzilla, or whatever I call it. The time to update your documents is mostly dominated by the time to actually parse Bugzilla by asking Bugzilla, tell me all the documents you have attached to. And the actual download is fairly minimal, so regardless of whether you have no documents or whether you're updating documents, your time isn't greatly different. You are making a lot of difference in bandwidth and the server, whether you start with a cache or not. But anyway, that process takes about 12 or 13 hours. So we don't update the document hoard every time we do a run. So it's actually pretty rare to update the hoard, so I do that maybe once a month, maybe less. That downloads a cache, so only new documents are updated. So we just ask Bugzilla for documents that match the mine types that we know. We don't double check it. So if it claims it's a doc, we just leave the doc, put it in the doc folder. So we've got lots of things like RTFs pretending to be docs and other file formats pretending to be a different file format than your suffix. It doesn't really matter, because if we can load it, we load it regardless of what category we put it into. We detect it at runtime. And all it just means is that when you look at the historical data, it'll tell you that there are a lot of doc crashes, and lots of those doc crashes are actually RTF crashes. Some of the RTF crashes are not RTF crashes, they're a different file format. So you can't just look at the columns and say this filter is, you know, absolutely useless. It might be one of the other ones is really at fault. So there's lots of miscategorized stuff in Mozilla, and there's lots of archive files in Mozilla, like zips and rars and things like that. And we don't download them, and we're not unzipping them. So there's a capacity to find more documents in the existing sources that we're looking at. So that's something that somebody might want to look into if they have an actual interest there. So so this is the import failures over time. These are just the builds. So we have like a crash test of LibreOffice.org, and on that we have the outputs and the CSV file. And every time we do the run, it just adds another line to it. So the entries here are just builds over time. But the first one we have there is October 2013. Generally, you get maybe one every week or so until we began getting very serious into just getting these numbers down. And then you had two bins, maybe three bins a week. But now for the last like 2 or 3 months, you're down to one bin a week. So they're not evenly spaced. Yeah, so I've actually taken out a few peaks from this diagram in order to actually fit things in, because otherwise if you just left in the original peaks, you'd have one gigantic peak and then just a straight line. You wouldn't be able to see any of the local ones. And so what tends to happen is we had a historical bunch of documents that were always crashing. Once we began taking the import crashing more seriously, we began to get that legacy amount of documents decreased over time. And then occasionally, somebody would either invent a new feature that didn't work as expected and cause a gigantic amount of documents to suddenly fail and fall over. Or if somebody added in the search to catch things that previously were just silently being ignored, so all these documents that were always working continued to actually really work or not. You know, there was no actual crashing, difference in their crashing in the real world, but we detected a whole pile of stuff. So yeah, you can use the import testing to find real-world examples of something that you think is a problem as well. So if you have like a legacy assert that just warns you investigate it closer, you realize that it's a real assert, you know, should be a real assert because this problem should never actually exist. You toggle it on, and if there is a document out there someplace in the hoard that has that comes through that bad case, then you can keep your eye on the results and they'll come true. And it's pretty standard, pretty common thing to happen in Writer, especially in layout asserts or the SW index assert that warns about patterns that have lived beyond, that live after the stuff that they pointed to has gone away. So that's the importing algorithm. There's a lot more documents involved in import than export. So you've got the 80,000 documents in import, but for export then you only have the subset for that export out to the common Office file formats. It is multiplied by about 3 from the input, because generally each document exports out to about 3 export file formats, but the numbers should be a lot smaller. Yeah, so even though the numbers of documents we're talking about are a lot smaller, you can see that initially, you know, we've got a huge amount of failures in some of those spikes there. It's like 3,500 failures versus, you know, the worst that ever happened on this chart is about 400. So, you know, there's a big difference initially in the quality of import export. So, relatively speaking, our import was never that bad when it comes to crashing. But when it comes to asserts and crashing on export, you know, it's a whole different story there. A lot of docx failures, especially a lot of doc failures, lots of crashes on the export to those file formats. Again, the scale is the same from about October 2013 to now as well. And again, you know, the overall trend is good. You know, it goes from big to small, and that's all that really matters. And you can get these places where lots of documents share the same floor. We like those ones. Yeah, so that was what we're doing during the last year. Last year, I hadn't looked at export crashes at all, but we had made some progress on import crashes. So the three things of our Coverity stuff, our import side crash testing, and then once that was finished, we kind of basically moved over to export crash testing. And obviously want to get the numbers down. So there was 1 week this year where we had the Coverity report came back at zero. There was zero import failures and there was zero export failures. So we hit the triple zero boiling point of water or whatnot. Yeah, and I thought it was kind of interesting because that happened on the week of 27th of August, and when an awful lot of people are on their holidays. So I guess what we need to do for better quality is just go on longer holidays and then problem goes away. So so that's, you know, obviously it's not a static project, and a lot of the reason we were doing this with Coverity ones was so we could get rid of legacy warnings, so when there was new warnings we would see them straight away so that you could tell that an actual new change had been made that triggered that and not that you're looking at old ones. Similarly for the import and export stuff here as well, it's also important not to crash the import and export, but you're really hoping to do is use the whole thing as an early warning system so that anything that goes wrong that creates a Coverity warning, an import crash, an export crash, can be detected pretty much in that week, so that the person who made the change that found that triggered it is still interested in fixing it, and not maybe 6 months later. So this is what you get typical for a typical run. Like this week we have 4 Coverity warnings, pending the next build, those 4 warnings are fixed. This week there's 0 import failures, and this week then there's 4 lines in the export output, and which has 4 documents there talking about 2 different issues. So you have 2 asserts that have are 2 problems that have appeared in the export this week. That's a fairly typical thing, and that's pretty much where we are. So as far as I'm concerned, I think that the whole thing is a success in that you have very, very small amounts of numbers. They do change over time a little bit, but you can use them to determine that a single individual has made a change that he needs to examine to see if it's something he needs to revisit within the week of him doing that. Right, so the reason I cared at all about the Coverity warnings and the import and the export stuff was so that I started because I was interested in just the quality of import and export from the sense of hitting off any security issues around file formats. But I didn't think there was a whole lot of point getting into document fuzzing and document filter analysis while you had all these actual real-world crashing test documents. There's no reason to go search for difficult crashing test cases when you had a pile of 80,000 documents that created, you know, 400 or 500 crashes in the first place. So now that we're kind of finished, I suppose, the easy easy real-world case of the import testing crash documents and the theoretical world for many of the conversion stuff when it comes to tainted data and things like that. We've made an effort there to validate data, and we've used Converging to tell us where some of this data might be data that's coming in from the outside that we haven't done any balance checking on. It's time to move on to generating troublesome documents and finding other crashes like that aggressively by going out and creating them myself. Yeah, so I've played with a couple of photos over the time. The search BFF is not bad. You get some good results out of that, but it's not super fast. I found the best one I've had so far is the AFL, the American Fuzzy Lop, and that's a lot of fun if you enjoy that kind of thing. So the best approach we have to use that is that you build your project with the replacement compilers of FLCLAN and FLCLAN++. And FL is a coverage-assisted fuzz testing tool. So it instruments your project, and it finds all the branch points, and it keeps track of what data that's read caused your project to go down one code branch or the other branch, and then it goes back and it generates input to make your to try and get you to go down the other path, so that it maximizes the coverage that your binary uses. And it's pretty good because it also has a lot of smarts built into it, and it knows how things go wrong, and it knows the kind of mistakes people make. So, you know, you turn it on and pretty fast it's giving you documents that are causing your integers to overflow and giving you zeros in all sorts of places. So, you know, you turn it on and just things just start breaking. And it's got a really great user interface. I just like this user interface a lot. It's just fabulous, like something from the 1980s, but it's got colours and things. That's really great. And there's a number of here cycles done, and you know, I don't really know how much of it works. I just read the readme and things like that, but what I do know is, you know, it's obviously grey up there in the top corner, and it's got cycles done, and when you make quite a bit of progress, it goes yellow. And I'm told that when you're coming close to exhausting all the possibilities of branches, and all the possibilities of your program, and that you're coming to the end of the process, that it goes blue. So one of the days, yeah, I see it go blue. It doesn't go blue yet. I'll give you some numbers on that as well. Now, the crucial bit for all of these fuzzy things is that they give you a document, you start your application, you import documentation, your application ends, and the crash testing, or in this case the fuzz crash testing, monitors to see if your application crashed or not, and then it restarts it again with different inputs. You know, it starts and stops. So, you know, again, because back in this user interface, there's a number for cycles. I won't show that screenshot because I want to, yeah. But there's a number that says how many executions there is per second. And if it's under 100 executions per second, the user interface goes red. So obviously the message you're getting there is that if you can't execute 100 times a second, your application is really too slow to be fuzzed effectively in this manner. So yes, their office itself, the office bin, the fat one, is really slow. So I was getting 0.18 executions a second just to load PNG. So that wasn't really where I wanted to be. So I found there that for just starting and stopping, that one of the big things we had was configuration loading. And parsing it is pretty expensive. Normally when you just have a fat binary, you load it once and then, you know, it doesn't matter too much. But for these little really tight loops, then the configuration is too expensive. So rather than use a fat office one, I use a much thinner custom written binary FF tester. That has no user interface and no configuration and so on. And number being that you get 40 executions a second for PNG, so that's 200 times faster, but still pretty slow. So yeah, I've got 5 minutes, or I've got 1 minute, so I'll speed it up. So yeah, so the whole point, I'll just get to the summary of the situation, which is that there's a special mode where you don't start and stop, you just load a document, you go to the next document, you just loop, and you inform the monitor that you're ready to go again. And that way then you lose all of the startup time you have. And when you do it that way, you get up to 3,000 or 4,000 executions per second. Right, so that's 20,000 times faster to work on a document, from 0.18 to 4,000. So that's a pretty big number. So you see here back on this, you've got like 3,700. That's a lot of execution per second. you only get those speeds with the simple documents. I have to say, when you get to the more complicated ones like Doc and PowerPoint, then you're talking like 50 or 60 executions per second. And in lots of cases, as you go over time, you go into these long, deep valleys for maybe a couple of hours where things are very slow. So as I said, we've got 64 core box for that. I've got currently about 20 plus instances running for the last month or so, and lots of documents are failing. But typically, what I'm finding is that crashes are very rare, but hangs are really common. Very, very common. So what I've done is started on the crash testing corpus, the full document we have for crash testing. I've taken that, I've run it through this minimizer that finds the minimum set of that, in the minimum set of documents from the inputs that basically exercises the maximum number of code paths. And I use that as the initial input. So yeah, those are our clips to date, and you've been seeing the results have been coming through over the last few weeks, and hope to progress. And I hope to see eventually that that little blue light shows up in the bottom and operate. Okay, then finished. Yes?
Yeah, I wanted to ask, so you can just terminate the process for a while, then
restart
in 2 days?
Yeah, so exactly. So I've run it for a couple of days between crash testing runs. I do the fuzzing runs, and then you generally find a bunch of hangs, fix the hangs, build the source again, do the crash testing for a day or two, then go back and fuzz, and you can restart, or at least use the interim inputs that you had at the time you exited, and build your state and continue from there. Any other questions, I guess? We haven't done it for a while, but we did do it for a bit. Yeah, that's pending. We were just talking about it yesterday that we haven't done it in a while, but we have done it in the past, and we have little results for that as well, but that does need to be updated. It's an undefined behavior one, we just sanitizer, and then there was a memory sanitizer as well, I think, the ASAN stuff. Any other questions, sir? No. Okay, that's it then. Thank you.